My name is Diego Martinez, and you're listening to the first episode of CHOONS, a podcast about the songs we vibe to. This is a show that explores the legacy of underrated music anthems, songs that have endured the test of time and have connected with millions of listeners everywhere, even if you haven't heard them yet. On each episode, we'll touch on these tunes with the people responsible for creating them. The producers, songwriters, arrangers, remixers, and the performers themselves. We call this group the Tune Architects. We begin our first season with two stellar guests, award-winning actress and singer Sheryl Lee Ralph, and legendary musician Trevor Lawrence, who will discuss the making of her 1984 club hit, In the Evening.
People had to wait for the lights to go dim, wait for the night to come on so that they could find their real selves and feel the music and dance into the night.
We're a working culture, so things happen after work. Work is work, and we all work, but after work is over. That's where the fun starts.
Sheryl Lee Ralph is one of the most beloved and recognizable figures in the entertainment industry. She is talented, outspoken, and multifaceted. Actress, singer, author, savvy entrepreneur, philanthropist, and fierce advocate for the causes that she believes in. Ms. Ralph is a diva in the truest sense of the word, and the acronym, Divinely Inspired, Victoriously Aware. She has over 100 acting credits to her name, according to her IMDb page. So chances are you have probably seen her work on the big and the small screen. She played Brandy's stepmom, Dee Mitchell, on 6 seasons of the UPN show, Moesha. And she also played Lauryn Hill's mother, Florence Watson, in the 1993 comedy film, Sister Act 2, Back in the Habit. But for many of us who know and respect Sheryl Lee Ralph, she will forever be remembered as an OG Dreamgirl.
Every man has his own special dream, and your dream's just about to come true. Life's not as bad as it may seem if you open your eyes to what's in front of you.
In 1981, Ms. Ralph was cast in a lavish musical written by Henry Krieger and Tom Ion, and directed by Michael Bennett, which follows the story of a female trio from Chicago called The Dreams. She played Dina Jones, a shy young woman who becomes a superstar, leaving behind her bandmates, Laurel Robinson, portrayed by Loretta Devine, and Effie White, a pivotal role that landed in the hands of then 21-year-old Jennifer Holliday. Dreamgirls became a Broadway sensation upon its premiere on December 20th, 1981 at New York's Imperial Theater. It spawned several national and international tours throughout the years, and a 2006 film adaptation that featured Beyoncé, Jennifer Hudson, and Jamie Foxx. Both Ms. Ralph and Ms. Holliday earned Tony nominations as Best Actress in a Musical for their respective roles. And although Ms. Holliday would end up with the award, all the cast benefited from the exposure. But after 1,000 rigorous performances, something had to give for Sheryl, forcing her to reevaluate her life and career choices, and ultimately leave Dreamgirls for good. This is where our story begins.
Something happened on stage. I literally just went blank. And it was one night only, second act. Then, you know, those fabulous costumes and the feathers and the big hair. I danced down center with Loretta to my left and Debbie to my right, and couldn't remember not one lyric. One night only, could not remember anything. I could hear the music clearly, but I could not remember one lyric. And that was enough for me. I was just like, you know something? It's time to go or take a very long vacation. Now, you know, shows are set up in a way where when a performer gets to that point, like in Wicked, you know, if someone hits that place, they take a sabbatical. They're out of the show for a month, 3 months, then they come back. Well, they hadn't really put that together for Dreamgirls. And we, the originals, were a big part of the success of the show. So when we weren't there, there'd be a dip in sales and they were not ready for that. So they wanted you to stay as long as you could, but I took a break because I was due a break. I got a call from my agent that said, Tim Flack, who was a big casting agent at CBS at the time, wanted me to come in on a role in a sci-fi series called V. And it was to play the head of an underground army, a warrior. And I said, wow, now that's a great departure from Dreamgirls. Who would connect this warrior woman with this Dina Jones on stage? And I got the role. And that was it. And I never came back. And I remember standing on stage saying, I think this is going to be my last performance. And everybody said, girl, please, you'll be back. And I never came back.
Meanwhile, on the West Coast, a legend was developing his songwriting skills. Trevor Lawrence had been involved in the industry since he was a child, picking up the saxophone as his instrument of choice. Before long, his talents were in demand by the biggest names in the music world. Trevor's extensive resume includes being on stage at Woodstock in 1969 as part of the Paul Butterfield Blues Band, touring with the Rolling Stones, and playing sax for legends like Etta James, Marvin Gaye, Ringo Starr, Carly Simon, and the genius Stevie Wonder. After moving to LA, his focus shifted to arranging, producing, and composing with his writing partner, Frank Musker, who has penned songs for Sheena Easton, Air Supply, The Babies, and Bette Midler. One of their earliest collaborations was the theme song for the Jackie Gleason and Richard Pryor film, The Toy.
A guy at the publishing company I was with came up and said, Trevor, he says, listen, there's a movie and they need a song for it and they gotta have it by Monday. They've tried everybody else and nothing worked. And so when I got that, then it just took me, you know, because I could look at it. They say, it needs to be something about, you know, this guy's getting this and that, you know. You tell me. So I said, okay. Oh, yeah. And so I came up with, I at that time, I wrote the music first, you know. So I wrote the music and I called Frank. I just said, Frank, we got to get this thing done. And he says, yes. I said, is this some guy, what about Just Want to Be Your Friend? Something like that. Frank is like the most brilliant writer. He came up with the lyric.
So you've done the things you thought you wanted to do, but they never fill that space inside of you.
What you need is someone who will understand. Come on, let me take your hand. I just want to be your friend. I had Jeffrey Osborne singing. I'm telling you, you know, so knowing the music, I mean, of course, somebody could have done that in a few days, or maybe somebody else could have done a better one at the same time. But that's the way, and that's how it's been with every song, you know. When I wrote All the Way Down for Etta James, you know, that was a situation. I put a line in there.
Beneath the albino says don't be a wino.
Try these ear fakes. They got what it takes to make you a star and change who you are all the way down. Now, you know, Benny the Albino was some kid that was like a bully when I was a kid growing up in Brooklyn. You know what I mean? And that whole thing about wino. You know, I mean, what I'm saying is that music has when you could organize things knowing something about the music, a lot of things could happen.
In early 1984, Trevor and Frank found themselves working with noted impresario Sid Bernstein. 20 years earlier, Bernstein helped jumpstart the British invasion as the first concert promoter that brought the Beatles over to America. Now he was interested in nurturing talent through his own record label, the New York Music Company. Sheryl Lee Ralph, working on her last dates as Dina Jones in Dreamgirls, was the first artist signed to the company.
Sid Bernstein got in touch with me and told me that he wanted me to work with Sheryl Lee Ralph. And so they flew me to New York. And I went and I saw the show.
I was literally doing Dreamgirls. Sid Bernstein comes to see the show. He sees me and he says, I have a hit record for you. I'm like, this is crazy. You know, none of it's really making any sense to me. I didn't have management at that time.
So when they brought me in, they were excited because they wanted to get a hit, you know. And so I went back to LA and I got with Frank. Actually, when I got back to LA, I wrote the tracks. I did the tracks for a few songs. I think one was You're So Romantic. And in the Evening, I think, was the first one that I recorded. Because I knew that was gonna be a hit because it was the right, you know, I wrote it that way, you know? I mean, in my business, you gotta believe every song's a hit because you don't get another gig if you don't get the hit. So back in those days, you know, everybody wants to make a hit, you know what I mean? But that's it. You wanna do something that you think everybody could love.
I end up recording this song. We weren't even in a studio recording it. It was like somebody's basement studio. You know, and it just happened, and I just went with the flow.
For Miss Ralph's singing debut, Trevor put pen to paper and envisioned the hustle and grind of a busy New York street and the quest for a more liberating experience after dark, a cue that had strong similarities to a million-selling single he wrote for the Pointer Sisters.
Started off the song with the same thing, you know, her telling the story. Where are people when you need them?
Where are people when you need them? When you need some help, they're just not around.
The same, you know, New York City. You know, you go somewhere in New York City, they ain't paying no attention to you. And then you got to get yourself, anybody work here? You know, it's the same thing.
Doesn't anybody work here? I ain't got all day. What a crazy town.
We're a working culture. So things happen after work. Work is work, and we all work. But after work is over, that's where the fun starts.
After dark, new energy finds me. I light up the night and live like a star. In the evening, the real me comes alive. I can feel it.
That's how it is for everybody. In the evening, the real me comes alive. Everybody, that's when, in all of the stories, you know, in the evening, the real me comes alive. In the evening is when you're done dealing with the man, busting your butt, trying to get accepted. And, you know, you go through all the works of it. And then in the evening, you know, the babies go to sleep and you and your lady are there by yourself and you come alive. And I think, you know, that's what you try to do. You always, Frank is so great with words. The thing is that the audience has got to be able to see or feel or sense their connection. Hey, that's me. You know? Yeah, they got to do that. The ones that are successful are the ones that people could really grab onto, you know, like I'm so excited. That's a true story, you know? That's how those things work. And there's a reason for that, but, you know. And then she said, tonight. We put all other things aside. That's how that song actually came about. Give in this time and show me some affection. Now that's a man begging somebody to forgive him. Let's get it.
And just like I'm So Excited, In the Evening is driven by an electrifying vocal performance, which shows off Miss Ralph's theatrical background.
You got to remember, Sheryl Lee is a theatrical singer. That's why she never made records, you know, because she was a theatrical kind of singer. She could sing in the theater. She could sing that stuff. Making a record is another thing. So when you hear her singing In the Evening, It's really like she's telling you the story from the stage, you know, instead of just a romantic person musing. That's why it's so believable. That's why it's so believable and why it brings you along. Because she's talking about something she knows about. She's not talking about you. She's talking about me. The real me comes alive, you know. Yeah, yeah, she did that. That's her voice. And she has like a very unique voice for a solo singer to me.
To tell you something, in creating those lyrics, it was literally creation, because in my creation of the character of Dina, I created a voice for Dina. And if you're not a performer, very often people don't understand what that means. Sometimes they think that you just get up there and use your voice, but it wasn't just about my voice, it was about the character's voice that I had to come into balance this with the story and the voice of Effie. So you hear that, you know, when she talks, it's more like this, you know, it's that, it's a higher pitched voice, it's airier, it's breathier. And when she sings, you know, it's that tiny little thing. And that's what they really wanted for In the Evening. So in some ways you hear that it's a higher, thinner voice. It's not at all like the voice that I usually use to perform or live with or live in. But for that song, it just worked. And so I just stuck with that. And every time I tried to break out with it, they'd say, no, go back to that. So I was like, oh my God, I sound like a chipmunk on speed, but it worked. It worked. I work like a soldier, working to live,
living for the night, in the evening. In the era of MTV, a song with such potential as In the Evening wouldn't be promoted without a music video. And this one is a total 80s extravaganza. Sheryl Lee Ralph's vision for the clip was that of a homeless Cinderella who had been given the chance to live out her fantasy of sporting killer looks and being swept away by a handsome man, all before midnight.
I wrote it. It was in my mind that this woman, this homeless woman, had a dream of greatness. She had a dream of beauty. She had a dream of love. She had a dream like Dorothy of the red sparkly shoes, you know, and I love the color red. And I said that, you know, she's got to fight those demons, right? Because they come for her and all she has is her dream, and it's in the shoe box, the shoes, you know, and she holds on to them and she fights them off. Then when it came to the whole dance scene on 42nd Street, it was the whole idea that there were a lot of people just like her who wanted to be free, who wanted to be able to just dance their dance no matter where they were. And so many of those people, if you look closely at them, they're quite famous now. You know, it's like I look at them and I say, I knew you had it, girl. I knew you had it. And I just love the whole feeling of it. And then at the end, you know, it all goes away. But she knows that she has it inside because she dances. She says, I got my dreams. And she's holding on to those red shoes.
When they made that video, I would never have thought of that. Me personally, I had nothing to do with it. It was their thing, you know. And apparently it worked out good for them, you know. I mean, I couldn't imagine a bag lady. I couldn't imagine none of that as being positive in a video, you know. But I've had other situations where people have decided to take it in their own hands and do their thing. But it was great.
When I did that, I was like, God, if people would just let me produce more of these music videos. But it was the very start of what we now know is the norm, and women are directing and producing. And I was just like, oh, but that's all right, because I did it. You know, I did it. I wrote it. I helped produce it. I made it happen. And it was great. And people still love that crazy video. I chopped all my hair off and everybody thought I'd lost my mind. They said, how are you going to be a dream girl looking like a glamorous punk rocker? And I was just like, hey, it's the change I need. The real me comes alive.
As a single, In the Evening had a respectable showing in the charts. It peaked at number 6 on Billboard's list of dance club songs in May 1984, and it reached number 64 in the UK. The song became a perennial floor filler in most places outside of the US. It was a level of success that caught the former Dreamgirl off guard.
I record this song and it becomes a summer hit. Then it starts rising on the Billboard charts, the dance charts. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so weird. Then I ended up doing this album. The album, you know, it did okay. Now people are starting to break the album apart and the album's starting to do so much better. 40 years later, I'm like, this is crazy. I did a lot of tours like through Europe because I was like, it was huge in Europe. You know, in Jamaica, it was huge. In Australia, it was huge. Latin America, huge. And I'm like, I knew nothing of this. Listen, had it happened now, it would be very different. But that's the way it happened. And it was just happenstance.
It took a while to really do what it had to do, you know, because I think the company didn't know exactly what to do. And there was a lot of things that went on. But it became a classic. It became a classic.
In the Evening perfectly captures the excitement of New York City in 1984. A buzzing city impacted by flashing lights, glamorous people, and pulsating beats that served as the scene's soundtrack.
Oh my God, the vibe was so amazing. People were dancing, people were clubbing, people were dressing up. It was like if you were young and experienced Saturday Night Fever, it was like that whole fever became sophisticated and classy and danceable, and the music, and Sylvester was around, and oh my God, Luther Vandross was coming up. A little girl from Detroit by the name, I forget the name she was going by, but became known as Madonna, was basically a club rat trying to make it. You know, people would do the clubs, you know, they would do, at that time, the baths, you know, and you'd be singing in these places trying to make yourself known and heard. It was just a different, wonderful time.
It almost felt like the party could go on forever, but unfortunately, it did not turn out that way.
Then HIV and AIDS, literally AIDS happened. And things just shifted. So it was like has been written before, it was the best and the worst of all times.
watching all of her friends in the industry afflicted by the HIV epidemic, including the creators of Dreamgirls, Ms. Ralph felt compelled to raise awareness and erase the stigma that is still connected with the disease, forming what is now known as the Diva Foundation.
People always ask, well, what do you do? And I'm like, we raise awareness. We've been raising awareness for over 30 years, especially in communities of color. And sometimes for me, it's sort of like mental illness. People can see if you broke your arm, but they can't see mental illness, just like they can't see awareness. But we continue to, and I always use this phrase, wave that flag, you know, that red flag to let people know that you matter in this fight. You matter in this disease. You matter in this virus. You matter in the change and development of healthcare, because I could see 30 years ago that things had to change for people of color and others. I could see that we were being left out. When it came to the fight around HIV and AIDS, I was stunned at how people found it easy to ignore communities of color. And then don't add a language on top of that. When there's a change in language, they ignore you even more. And then to be a person of color and speak another language, oh honey, you're like invisible. And I was able to see that. And I could not understand why people could not understand the importance of raising awareness about bringing the message to people in their community from people that they could identify with.
For the past 30 years, the Diva Foundation has used the transformational power of the arts as a catalyst for change. Ms. Ralph and her network of friends and colleagues have been able to raise funds through Divas Simply Singing, the longest-running musical HIV/AIDS benefit in the U.S. She continues to fight for social justice and access to healthcare, juggling her advocate work with acting and other endeavors. Ms. Ralph currently has a recurring role as the President of the United States on Freeform's motherland, Fort Salem. She has also expanded her memoir, Redefining Diva 2.0, Life Lessons from the Original Dreamgirl, as an audiobook available on Audible. Trevor Lawrence continues to make exciting music, this time together with Japanese pianist Masumi Yamamoto. Their most recent collaboration is a live acoustic album called Crater in the Moon, which you can listen to on YouTube. As Ms. Ralph and Trevor Lawrence look back on the legacy of In the Evening, they both note how the track was adopted by members of the LGBTQ+ community upon its release. It spoke of their desire to embrace their authentic self despite experiencing rejection from other parts of society.
First, it was the gay community that really embraced it. I mean, you know, when they embraced it and took it on as their anthem, I'm talking about around the world, in England too, you know, and in Netherlands. Once that happens and people recognize that, hey, that's my story, that's when the whole thing comes together. You know, that's how those things work.
I love the fact that the song resonated and still resonates to this day with the gay community. That's another great gift, another group of people that continue to give back to me. And it is with great understanding that people had to wait for the lights to go dim, wait for the night to come on so that they could find their real selves and feel the music and dance into the night, to dress up, put on the makeup, you know, to become their real selves, to become at times somebody else. There is magic and power in that. And then 40 years later, to see how things have changed. When I look at Pete Buttigieg, I'm just like, the real me comes alive and the real me is out of the dark. When I look at Kaylin Allen doing his whole thing on social media and TV, I'm like, and there you have it, darling. When I look at Todrick Hall, you know, and that whole album, Boys Wear Pink, I'm like, yes, children, yes. There are just so many great people who are like transitioning into their real life. MJ Rodriguez, Angelica Ross, you know, the real me has come alive on both sides of the gender issue. And you know, it's so interesting to support people becoming their real selves, because people want to give you hell for living your life. And that to me is problematic in some ways. And then people can be so deep in their rejection of others that when you say, can't we all just get along? They want to hurt you by asking you, well, what's wrong with you? And then you're like, wait a minute. All I'm saying is that people should be allowed to live their lives. And that's very difficult for people to come to terms with.
The fight for LGBTQ plus rights is certainly not over in the US and in other countries around the world. However, there is hope in the air. We have come a long way from those heady days of 1984, where we had to seek refuge in the dark in order to live our truth. I personally have so much faith in young queers, taking a page from Ms. Ralph's book on embracing an honest and unapologetic life, day in and day out.
The real me is always out there. I am not waiting for shade. I am not waiting for dim lights. I'm not waiting for the darkness. I am living my truth out loud. That's just me. It is too painful to wait for anything. Plus, you know, I was raised in the West Indian life that says what is done in the dark will come to truth in the light. So I'm like, you might as well see it in the light, baby. So that's my approach. It's inspirational art. It is victorious music. And it's just an awesome song that will live probably longer than I am, because everybody's going to know that there is some song that speaks right to them and their dreams coming true in life and on the dance floor.
Thanks to Sheryl Lee Ralph and Trevor Lawrence for their contributions, and thank you for tuning in to this first episode of our show. Tunes is a series of music memoirs produced and hosted by Diego Martinez. My executive producer is Nick Fresh, and my audio engineer is Adam Fogel. If you want to join the conversation and see exclusive content related to this story, be sure to follow us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, at CHOONSPOD, that is CHOONSPOD. Rate us and give us a review on Apple Podcasts and subscribe wherever you get your podcast. Join us next time as we take a trip down memory lane on another episode of CHOONS.